Romans 8:28. It's that verse that says, "And we know that all things work together for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to his purpose." We've repeated it, maybe even consoled people with it, right? Maybe even shared it on social media. Those of you who are into social media, all things work together for good to those who love God. If that's the case, if we do believe that God is sovereign, why do we have moments in which we do not act or operate in such a way that God is sovereign? Those are the first two blanks in your notes. Why is that? If we believe this to be true, if we believe that... Am I on here? No? Test 1, 2. Test 1, 2. Test 1, 2. 1, 2, 3. I'll stay over here if I need to while you're looking for it. So if that's the case that we do believe, hey, I think I'm on now. If we do believe that God is sovereign, why is it that we have moments that it doesn't look like we believe God is sovereign? Does that make sense to you? Before I get ahead of myself too far, let's take a moment and define what we mean by God is sovereign. So let's just go first into a definition of the word sovereign. It's an adjective, and it means above or superior to all others, chief, greatest, supreme. It also means supreme in power, rank, or authority. Also, of or holding the position of ruler, royal, reigning. It also means independent of all others, like a sovereign state. You've heard it used that way probably as well. And so it's important for us to first understand, what does this word sovereign mean when we say God is sovereign? And when you consider that description of the word sovereign, we also have to be truthful and we must declare that God's Bible, the Word, is very clearly, it does communicate God's sovereignty time and time again. The Bible clearly communicates God's sovereignty. And we see this in Genesis 1:1, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. In John 1:1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. In Psalm 147:5, great is our Lord and abundant in power. His understanding is beyond measure. In Psalm 90, verse 2, before the mountains were brought forth or ever you had formed the earth and the world, from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. Matthew 10:29-31, are not two sparrows sold for a penny, and not one of them will fall to the ground apart from your Father. But even the hairs of your head are numbered. Fear not, therefore, for you are of more value than many sparrows. Do you see God's sovereignty in all these scriptures I'm sharing? His authority, his supremacy, his power, his rank. Colossians 1:16-17. For by him all things were created in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things were created through him and for him. And he is before all things, and in him all things hold together. God is sovereign. He is sovereign. He's on that throne. And the interesting thing about God's sovereignty is it's one of the most important principles in Christian theology. Plus, it's also one of the most hotly debated. What can God do? What cannot God do? Does that make sense? What can he do? What can't he do? And that's one thing that comes up when we come to God's sovereignty and his power and his rule and authority. It's this reality of what does he and does he not do. And I'm not really that interested in going into a lot of theological teaching about God's sovereignty, but I'm really more interested in the practical teaching. However, you cannot simply be practical without getting into the theological part of God's sovereignty, because the theological part of God's sovereignty, I'm still not on, I'll stay here. The theological part of God's sovereignty is the why. Does that make sense? It's the why. Why is God sovereign? How is God sovereign? Maybe you do not realize this, but the sovereignty of God, it impacts your everyday life. And the first thing that I want to share with you about how that is that first, if God is sovereign, all cause for worry is removed. All cause for worry is removed. If God is the supreme ruler on the throne of the universe and on the throne of your life, all cause for worry is removed. The God of this universe not only loves me, but he's capable of caring for me. He's capable of caring for me and for you. Romans 8:28. Right? All things work that we know that in all things work together for good for those who love God, to those who are called according to his purpose. It's this idea that if all things are his purpose, all things are his plan, all things ultimately do come from him, I don't have to worry. How else does God's sovereignty impact your everyday life? Well, we can trust God in doing his part of sanctification. I know, big word. We can trust him in doing his part of sanctification. Many Christians believe, plus I know I've taught it plenty of times, that growing and maturing as a Christian in the Christian faith, it's all up to us. We've got work to do. Work out your own salvation, right? With fear and trembling. And sure, Christians do play a major role in their own maturity. However, as the scripture does call on Christians, to play this major part, but the scripture calls on the believer to do certain things. However, there's this portion, this other portion of our growth that you would have to admit is truly supernatural. That there are parts of your Christian growth as you look back and you say, that is God doing that in my life. That is God growing me in that way. I had somebody share with me recently, and I can't share any details about somebody who was arguing with them and how they were just totally able to keep their cool. Somebody was getting very agitated at them, and they were just able to stay calm. And they said, you know what? That was God. God did that for me. He's so good. God did that for me. There are parts of our sanctification, or I should say, God has this major role of our sanctification, our maturity, our growing, and we can trust God to do his part in this maturing. We can trust him with this. Yes, there's part of that, where we pursue him, we study the scriptures, we pray, we do things to come closer with him. But there's this supernatural side that we just cannot conjure up and we can't work up. It's his work. I like how Philippians 1:6 says it, and I am sure of this, that he who began a good work in you will bring it to completion at the day of Jesus Christ. He began the work and he continues to do it. That's God. He began it, he continues it, because he's sovereign. He's sovereign. Another way that God's sovereignty impacts my everyday life, it affects how you and I make decisions. How we make decisions. That's the next blank in your notes. If you and I recognize that God is in control, we understand that that we do not need to be so paralyzed by decision making. And now, so I get it. Some of you would even admit I'm more of a follower than a leader. You know, that's just not my DNA. You know, I'm just not made. You know, I'm not that type A person to be out there leading and to be the one doing all the talking. I get that. But you still have to make decisions, whether you're an extrovert or an introvert. We all have to make decisions. And the great thing is that because God is sovereign, we don't have to be so paralyzed about that. If I make a bad decision, all is not lost. If I make a bad decision, all is not lost. It's not like the end of all things. Now, granted, it depends on how far you take that bad decision, right? But the reality is that. I mean, have you ever made a bad decision? Oh, let me share. When I think of bad decisions in my life, financial ones come to mind. Oh, my goodness. I remember this time shortly after Susan and I got married, probably around 1994, and she and I decided that we needed to get some more reliable transportation. She knows exactly where I'm going with this. We needed to get some more reliable transportation. I had this old Honda Civic that my dad and mom had bought me back in high school, and boy, it was starting to smoke. You know, it's getting pretty smoky. It was burning some stuff. And Susan and I came up with this great idea that we needed a new car, a new one. We couldn't afford a new car, but we wanted a new car. So since we couldn't afford to buy a new car, we decided this grand idea that we would lease a new car. And we leased a new car for, I think it was a 36-month lease. 300 months, she said. It seemed like 300 months. It seemed like it just took forever for this lease. Yeah, have you ever made a bad financial decision, and as you're driving home, you're holding your stomach, and you're thinking, I think I'm going to be ill. I feel nauseous. I think I just made a bad decision when I signed my name on that paper, that contract, back then, right? Contract. That binding, legally binding agreement. We had nothing to show for it at the end because we couldn't afford the car at the end of the lease to buy it out. So nothing after 36 months of making payments. However, God used that bad financial decision by providing us wisdom for future decisions. Now, I'm not saying that all financial decisions that we've made in our household since then have been great and perfect and, you know, that they've been wise. No, we certainly learned a great lesson, though, from this instance. And we trusted the Lord to see us through it. And He did. He did. When we speak of God's sovereignty, we have to be sure to include the fact that we are still make decisions. God's rule and superiority and just, you know, His authority doesn't mean I just sit back and wait. It doesn't mean that you just sit back and wait. Now, there are times of waiting, yeah? But it doesn't mean you make no decisions. You don't do anything. You make decisions. You still do. We can have confidence and courage that as we make decisions in life, He's sovereign. Why would I have confidence? Well, because the sovereign God of this universe doesn't just exist around me. No, He abides within me. He abides within you. 1 John 3:24, whoever keeps His commandments abides in God and God in him. And by this we know that He abides in us by the Spirit whom He has given us. And 1 John 4:13, by this we know that we abide in Him and He in us because He has given us of His Spirit. Abiding presence. abiding presence in making decisions. So we can draw another conclusion. When you and I are abiding in Christ and he in us, because he's given us of his Spirit, we know that we are not making decisions alone. We're not making these decisions alone. We have his presence in us and him empowering us. You can ask for wisdom. How about that? And you can trust God to give you wisdom. I always get in trouble when I don't ask for wisdom. That's when I have issues, is when I make decisions and I'm not asking for the Lord's wisdom. James 1:5, if any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask God, who gives generously to all without reproach, and it will be given him. So when you and I ask for wisdom, we don't have to feel as if we're just rolling the dice, right? We're not, well, maybe. We're not just taking this chance. We're calling on the sovereign God of the universe. See, it all comes back to that point, doesn't it? It has to come back to God's sovereignty. He truly is the ruler and the head of all things. He is supreme. I remember back when Susan and I were praying about coming to Goshen Friends Church. And I had the trial sermon. and you all voted the same day. That's kind of strange, y'all. I don't know why you all did that. I'll blame Doug Dodson. He's not even listening. Oh, he heard his name. He was talking, and I just got his attention. Anyway, the vote was unanimous, of course, for me to be your pastor. And after that, Susan and I entered into a period of prayer. Here's the cool thing. Not once did I feel as if my prayers were just evaporating. They're just, nothing's happening, you know. No, there was a peace, a confidence that God was providing wisdom and this, just to accept the invitation to come here, to be your pastor. One last way that I'd like to point out how God's sovereignty impacts my everyday life is this. He provides our sense of identity. Oh, this is a huge one, y'all. Big, big point here. He provides your sense of identity, who you are. How does God's sovereignty do that? Well, when you and I consider that the all-powerful God of the universe is on the throne of the whole universe, he knows you, it changes you. When the God of the universe knows you, you recognize he knows me, and he doesn't just have some knowledge of my existence, he knows me better than I know me. Transforms my identity on how I feel about myself. There's a peace that only his sovereign character can provide. So the other night, as the sun was going down, I went for a walk. I'd been feeling especially lonely that evening. I mean, do you ever feel lonely? Am I the only one that feels lonely sometimes? Let's be honest. I was lonely. Lonely. You ever just get into that funk of feeling isolated? And I felt that way. Every once in a while I'll feel that way. So I went for a walk. And it was a prayer walk. And I left my phone at home. So there were going to be no interruptions or distractions, no other voices. But it was just me and God having a conversation. And like all evenings here lately, it was a gorgeous, cool evening, clear. The sun was setting, and I'm talking to God. The colors were just great. And it was quiet, and I asked God to remind me of who I am. Lord, remind me who I am. Because you see, When I get to feeling lonely a lot of times, it has to do with my identity and how I view who I am. And taking into consideration the sovereignty of God into that equation. God is sovereign. Who am I, God? Who am I? And he was faithful. Because by the end of the walk, I was all right. He reminded me on that prayer walk who I am. He also caused me just to intersect with another Christian couple that were out for a walk that evening that just really encouraged me. He is so good. So I began this sermon with Romans 8:28, and we're going to head back to Romans 8 again. I'm going to turn there, and as we read the rest of Romans 8, I want to invite you that as we're reading this, and of course the scripture will be on the slides if you don't have a Bible with you, please, as we read this, consider it through the lenses of God's sovereignty, okay? So we're reading Romans 8, 29 through 39. Be thinking about God's sovereignty when we do so, okay? For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, in order that he might be the firstborn among many brothers. And those whom he predestined, he also called. And those whom he called, he also justified. And those whom he justified, he also glorified. What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own Son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things? Who shall bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? Christ Jesus is the one who died, more than that, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed is interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all the day long. We are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am sure that neither death nor life nor angels nor rulers nor things present nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus, our Lord. God's sovereignty. Oh. God's sovereignty. So, brothers and sisters, with God in control in our hearts and minds, if we can elevate him to sovereignty and keep him there, we can experience complete peace and confidence, abundant life, growth, maturity. God is in control. And I'm able to act and operate in that truth. And the question is, have you crossed over from a head knowledge of God's sovereignty to a lived out experiential practice where the rubber meets the road? How sovereign is your God? Father, we thank you so much for how you, Lord,
promise to love us always, to never leave us nor forsake us. No matter if we're having a good day or a bad day, no matter if we've made good decisions or bad decisions, you keep pursuing us. Why? Well, because you're sovereign. You love us so much. Father, as we just consider of just your love for us, as we consider your love for us, and as we take into consideration your sovereignty and how we ought to be operating under that truth, I pray, Lord, that today, hopefully, we all have been able to have our eyes opened a little wider, our hearts a little softer to receive the truth of your sovereignty. Now, Lord, we know that we're a work in progress. We get that. But we're so glad we're not alone in this. You meet us right where we are and love us too much to leave us there. Now, Lord, we just give you glory and thanks. We take great confidence and have such peace that you do leadeth me. In Jesus' name, amen.
This closing song, He Leadeth Me, is just absolutely perfect for what we just heard. And I find it interesting that God is sovereign whether I recognize that or not. And I love the fact that that song is He Leadeth Me, it's not He Draggeth Me. That, I mean, He's given us free choice, but the best thing that we can do is to willingly let Him lead us. I'm glad He doesn't conk us over the head and drag us, because then what joy would that give us to serve Him? Or what joy would He receive from us obeying Him? So stand with us while we sing He Leadeth Me.
He leadeth me. my task. On earth is done when by thy grace the victory's won. Even death's cold wave I will not believe, since God through Jordan leadeth me. He leadeth me, he leadeth me by his own hand, he leadeth me. His faithful follower I would be, for by his hand he leadeth me.
Thank you.